sermon this morning is called One Life and the Word. At a time when the lives of almost everyone have been turned upside down, there is one and only one who can bring peace. There is only one Prince of Peace. The Prince of Peace is Jesus. Jesus is not from some of these days. Have you noticed? There's a lot of discussion about who Jesus was. Is Jesus just an ethical philosopher? Was he just a good man? Was he just a moral teacher? Was he any different from other religious leaders? Was he really the divine Son of God? Many people have made their contributions to make the world a better place. Kings, presidents, religious leaders, military leaders, scientists, and artists have made their mark on the world and made their names famous. One name stands above all others. His name is Jesus, the Prince of Peace, the Messiah, the Savior. Jesus is perhaps the most famous, well-known name in history. There is one thing to have heard his name, and another to know who he really is. It's my hope that today's sermon will reach someone who needs to meet the name of Jesus. I would like to introduce you more fully to the Jesus of history and the Jesus of the Bible. You may be questioning, was Jesus really who people say he was? Was he really the Son of God, the Savior? After the devastating disappointment of his crucifixion, two of his followers had these questions as well. Jesus had been crucified instead of becoming king in Jerusalem and overthrown the Romans as they had hoped. They were discouraged and disillusioned as they stumbled back to Emmaus from Jerusalem. The resurrected Jesus appeared and began walking and talking with them. He explained to them the prophecies that had been fulfilled, including the disappointing events of the last few days. Luke 24:25 says, "O foolish one, and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." Wouldn't you have liked to have heard that by the way? Prophecy after prophecy was explained until they saw clearly that indeed he was the promised Messiah. Let's look at some of the evidence that Jesus may have appeared on the Emmaus Road that evening. Number one, his miraculous birth. Long before Jesus was born to Mary, Isaiah prophesied, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." Emmanuel means God with us. And Mary, the young unmarried virgin, was informed by an angel that she would have her child, and that this child would be the one who would save the people from their sins. Matthew 1:21. It's an amazing story. Matthew 1:18. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, he was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Number two, his first place. Not only was the manner of Jesus' birth predicted, but also where he would be born. Micah 5:2 says, "Bethlehem, Ephrathah, out of you shall come forth to me the one to be ruler." It is remarkable that Jesus is born in Bethlehem, the exact city which the prophecy predicted 700 years in advance. We see in Matthew 2:1, Jesus was born in Bethlehem. The New Testament confirms the fulfillment of Micah's prophecy. The newly married couple, Mary and Joseph, were visiting Bethlehem to comply with the Roman census and taxation decree. There was no room in the inn, so they found shelter in the stable. There it was that Jesus was born. Luke 2:7. And she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Jesus is more than a good man, more than an ethical teacher, more than a moral philosopher. Jesus was the divine son of God. He was born of a virgin, as the prophet Isaiah predicted. He was born in Bethlehem, as the prophet Micah predicted. Why did Bible prophecy clearly reveal the significant details in Christ's life hundreds of years in advance? Why did God make it so clear that these prophecies were fulfilled for the prophet? You see, when Adam made sin, back in the beginning, God had to do something. He had to make a plan to save the human race. His plan called for Jesus, his son, to come to earth, live a perfect life, and die in our place for our sins. This is the plan of salvation. The plan of salvation cannot save us unless we recognize and accept it. The prophecies were given so that we can know and believe in Jesus as the Savior of the world. Soon after he was born, we see this happening. There were wise men from the East who carefully studied the scriptures. They understood the prophecies of the great deliverer that was to appear, and knew it was time for him to arrive. When they saw a new star appear leading them toward Judea, they recognized it as the sign of the newborn king. In Bethlehem, they found Jesus and bowed down and worshiped him. Thus began a truly remarkable life. Jesus, though he was God, lived on this earth as a humble, hard-working, self-sacrificing servant. Notice how the Apostle Paul describes this act of self-sacrifice. Psalm 14:6. Who, being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, and then coming in the likeness of man. Jesus became like us so that he could be our example for living on this earth. But his life was pure and sinless so that he could be our sacrifice and die in our place for our sins. And he didn't just fulfill prophecies in his birth and life, but also in his death. Evidence number three is betrayal. Take this betrayal by Judas as an example. It is predicted in detail by the psalmist. Psalm 41:9. Even my own familiar friend and him oppressed, who ate my bread, has lifted up his spear against me. When at the Last Supper, Peter asked Jesus who was going to betray him, Jesus answered, "It is he to whom I forgive a piece of bread when I have gifted." This stage of prophecy foretold that it was one of those closest to Jesus who betrayed him to his death. Number four, the price paid to the traitor. Scriptures were even specific about his betrayal, even detailing the price paid to the traitor. Zechariah 11:12. So they weighed out with my wages 30 pieces of silver. Again, the New Testament records that this was precisely fulfilled. Matthew 26:14, then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and said, "What are you willing to give me? I deliver him to you." And they counted out to them 30 pieces of silver. Number 5, the beating and abuse. The manner and cruelty of his betrayal was also foretold. He was to be beaten and abused. Isaiah 56. I gave my back to those who crushed me, and my cheeks to those who plucked out the beard. I did not hide my face from pain and spitting. Did that happen? That's the prophecy fulfilled. Matthew 26:67. Then they spat in his face and beat him, and others struck him with the palm of their hands. Number 6, they pierced his hands and feet. The way he was to die was also specified in the Old Testament by the prophet. His hands and feet were to be pierced. Psalm 22:16. They pierced my hands and my feet. After the resurrection of Christ, Thomas, one of his disciples, who doubted that he had been resurrected, made reference to the fact that Christ's hands and feet were indeed pierced. He said, "Unless I see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my fingers into the print of the nails, put my hand into his side, I will not believe." When Jesus later appeared to Thomas, he showed his wounds as the evidence that he was the same Jesus who had been crucified. Number 7, he was numbered with transgressors. The scriptures also reveal an effect that he would be associated with sinners. For Isaiah tells us that he would be numbered with the transgressors, Isaiah 53:12. Notice how this prophecy of Christ was directly fulfilled. And in Mark 16:27, with him they also crucified two robbers, one on his right and the other on his left. So the scripture was fulfilled with Christ, and he was numbered with the transgressors. Number 8, they cast lots for his clothing. King David told what would happen to Jesus' clothing 1,000 years before he died. Psalm 22:18. They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Imagine how specific this prophecy is. The Roman soldiers who oversaw his crucifixion were unlikely to have known what David had written, but their actions fulfilled it exactly. In the New Testament, John 19:23, it says, "Then the soldiers took his garments and made 4 parts. Now the tunic was without seam, woven from the top in 1 piece. They said, 'Let us not fear, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be.'" Number 9, his words on the cross. Even Jesus' words of his own upon the cross were predicted by the psalmist. Psalm 22:1, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Compare this Old Testament verse with Matthew 27:46, and we see that Jesus uttered these words just before his death. "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" These are prophecies that are amazingly specific, yet accurately fulfilled. Many of these prophecies were totally beyond human control. Jesus could not have simply arranged for them to come to pass as predicted. He could not have arranged the place of his birth, the manner of his birth, his betrayal, or the events surrounding his death. Jesus was clearly who he claimed to be, the Messiah. He is God in human form. As he hung on the cruel cross, he was isolated from being, nailed in pain and fatigue, with a crown of thorns on his head, being mocked and jeered at. He could have, with one word, commanded the angels of heaven to deliver him. But he didn't. He could have saved himself, but he couldn't save himself and us too. The Son of God consented to hang on that cross and give himself for our salvation. Why did he do it? He did it because he loved you. He loved you, and he loved me. As we look at the cross, that love takes us from our pride from it. It prompts us to want to love Jesus because of his great love for us. He did it because it was the only way that we could be saved to live with him forever. The Bible says of his sacrifice, he was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was freed for our iniquities, and by his stripes we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. He was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter. This is only one of the many times that Jesus is referred to in the Bible as an innocent man. Revelation 13:8 speaks, "The book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world." It speaks of the Lamb as being worthy of worship. The 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Yes, the innocent Lamb died for the guilty sin. Sin separates us from God, the source of life. It brings death, as Romans tells us. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Adam and Eve, separated from God by sin, were banished from the Garden of Eden and could no longer eat of the tree of life. It says in Genesis 3:24, so he drove out the man and placed cherubim at the east of the Garden of Eden, and a flaming sword was pointed every way to guard the way to the tree of life. But even God told them of his plan to save them. Genesis 3:15, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise your heel. What does it mean to bruise? The Hebrew word for bruise means to crush. To crush one's head is more serious than to bruise one's heel. Christ will be the victory over Satan. So they would be reminded of the innocent enemy, the Son of God, who would one day die for their sins, and instructed them to offer their own reign as a sacrifice. In the sacrificial system, they were to show their faith in the Lamb of God, Jesus, who would one day die to give them eternal life. In the very next chapter, after the fall of man, we see Cain and Abel bringing offering sacrifices to God. Genesis 4:4. Abel offered blood of the firstborn of his flock, and of his fat, the Lord respected Abel and his offering. But he did not respect Cain and his offering, and Cain was very angry. Abel obediently brought a lamb, representing the Lamb of God, the king disobeyed and brought food as a sacrifice. the fruit can never appropriately represent the sacrifice made by Jesus. For the book of Hebrews tells us, without shedding of blood, there is no remission. When God brought the Israelites out of Egypt, he had Moses build a tabernacle, a portable temple that was modeled after the sanctuary in heaven. The ceremonies of the sanctuary symbolize the advance of the plan of salvation. One of these ceremonies was the Passover. It commemorated the time when Israelites left Egypt. The people were instructed to kill a lamb and put a blood on their doorpost. It was a sign of their obedience to the faith and the blood of the coming lamb. That night, the destroying angel passed over the homes that were covered by blood, did not harm anyone inside. But throughout the land of Egypt, in homes where the blood was not melting the doorposts, the firstborn of man and beast died. Passover was to remind them that only the blood of the lamb can deliver them from destruction. It not only pointed backwards to their deliverance from Egypt, but forward to the time when the real Passover lamb would be slain. The animals that were sacrificed did not cleanse from sin. Hebrews 10:4, for it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats could take away sin. Only through the blood of the real sacrifice, Jesus, the Son of God, could sin be forgiven. Hebrews 9:26 says, he has appeared to take away sin by the sacrifice of himself. The ceremonial system of sacrifices had been pointing forward to the Messiah, the Lamb of God. The shed blood of every dying lamb in the Old Testament had for centuries represented Jesus' shed blood for us. This is why when John the Baptist announced the Messiah and pointed to Jesus, he said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus is the Savior of the world. Jesus pardons. Jesus forgives. Jesus delivers us from guilt. Jesus teaches us how to live. Jesus' life is an example for us. Jesus empowers our lives. Jesus changes us from within. And Jesus gives us new life. During one of Sir Ernest Shackleton's attempts to cross the Antarctic Ocean in 1914, his ship, the Endurance, was crushed in an ice floe. The crew drifted for days until they could make a landing on Elephant Island. Shackleton had the men set up camp there where they could preserve their supplies and try to survive the coming winter. But he soon realized that no one would be coming to rescue them. No one had any idea where they were. They were cut off from the world by the freezing, stormy, fantastic ocean. There was only one hope of a rescue. Someone had to cross that hostile ocean and get help. Shackleton began to rig a 20-foot whaling boat for the voyage. And volunteers who took a period of trip. They would have to cross 800 miles of tempestuous sea in order to reach a Norwegian whaling station on the frozen islands of South Georgia. It seemed an impossible task in an open boat at the stormiest time of year. The Shackleton set out for this man. For days, they huddled into a makeshift canvas, tugging, keeping the bow hanging into the fiercest waves, praying that the wind wouldn't blow their small sail away. They endured bone-chilling cold, sleeping bags frozen stiff, icy water streaming down their backs, hunger and thirst. 14 days after their voyage began, when all were almost dead of exposure and thirst, they spotted the black cliff of South Georgia. Shackleton had made it through. Soon the ship would be on its way to rescue the rest of its stranded men. When God looked down at our predicament and saw that we were isolated on an island, surrounded by the downward sea of sin, he plunged into the hostile sea himself. He took us on himself, the murderous, icy vastness of the evil in human hand. There is no one else in our universe like Jesus. He is the only one who can save us. He is the only one who can take away our guilt and change our lives. He is the only one who can offer us eternal life. Wherever you are this morning, would you like to say, "Yes, Jesus, I accept you today as my Lord and Savior"? Would you like to say, "Yes, Lord, I believe you died for me. Yes, Lord, I give my life to you"?